Hello, everybody. Welcome to another React Wednesdays. My name is TJ Van Tol. I work as a developer advocate at Progress. With me, as always, Dan Wilson. Dan, how are you doing?
Hey, doing good. I'm Dan Wilson. I work with Digital Primates, and we do enterprise React consulting. And we curate the Enterprise React newsletter. So if that's your kind of thing, Google it.
Awesome. And like I said, this is React Wednesdays. This is a stream we do every week. We bring in cool people from around the React world. We talk about fun React stuff. So in a minute here, we're going to welcome Brandon Bayer in to talk about Blitz.js. But I just wanted to give a quick shout out for some of our other upcoming shows. We're going to be talking next week with some people from Microsoft about building Teams apps with React, which, Dan, I think that's something you've been playing with a little bit also.
So yeah, for sure. It's really powerful.
It's cool stuff. After that, the week we have Remotion with Johnny Berger. And if you haven't seen this before, it's an incredibly cool demo. Basically, you're building videos with React. So I'm kind of excited for this. I think it also, it's another one of those things that's going to make for a really good demo, I think, just because it's so visual. So that should be a lot of fun. And finally, to wrap up the month, we've got Dave McCabe from Facebook to talk about Recoil. So fun, different state management library with React. So cool episodes coming up. Telerik.com/React Wednesdays. If you want to learn more, add things to your calendar, subscribe, all those good sorts of things. But today we're talking Blitz.js. And to do so, first, I want to welcome one more member of our panel here, Mickey Smith. Once I'm playing with Windows. Hey, Mickey, how are you doing?
Hi, guys. I'm good.
You want to tell people who you are, what you do, that sort of stuff?
Yeah, exactly. So as you mentioned, I'm a member of Digital Primates. I'm a junior dev there, and I work on React and JavaScript at an enterprise scale.
Awesome. And so with all of us here now, I think it's time to welcome in our special guest for today and welcome Brandon Bayer to the virtual stage. Brandon, how are you doing?
Great. How are you?
I'm doing all right. You want to tell people who you are, what you do, why Blitz.js is awesome, all those good sort of things?
Sure. So I'm Brandon Bayer. I'm the creator of Blitz.js and its lead maintainer. And I've been working on Blitz for just over a year now. And for the past 3.5 years, approximately, I've been doing consulting, building full stack apps for mostly small startups. And so, yeah, I just got tired of messing with libraries and servers and all the kind of chaos and complexity that goes into building full stack React apps. And a year ago, I just kind of had a conversation with a friend that sparked now's the right time to build a framework, a full stack framework for React. And so that's why I started Blitz. And so Blitz is built on.
I think we lost Brandon here for a second.
I think the Next.js mafia cut his stream.
Okay, back now? About. I think your video is still frozen, but we hear you now.
Okay, cool. So Blitz is built on top of Next.js and brings in Prisma as a default database layer for the ORM. And then the really big thing that Blitz adds is the zero API data layer, which abstracts away the API so you don't have to mess with REST or GraphQL.
Yeah, I have to say, number one, since we booked you a few weeks ago, I've noticed your popularity seems to increase. How are you handling the throngs at your front door throwing flowers? Is that something you've gotten used to yet, or can you get enough celebrity?
I mean, it's tough, but, you just kind of deal with it.
Just kind of deal with the paparazzi. Yeah, the other thing is, I'll confess, I let 25 cool domain names go last year, finally, after I agreed I wasn't really going to build the apps I thought would be cool for the domain name. And the reason why is whenever I want to build an app, there's 20% of the app that's the cool part that solves the business problem. And then there's all this other stuff you have to set up to get to the point where you can actually build and deliver the cool stuff. And frankly, setting up a server and starting off the authentication and getting a database configured, these are all utility tasks. And I don't like doing them. I've done them for 20 years, and I just want them to be magically done for me. So I could not be happier to see Blitz in action. I've been going through the tutorials. It's as powerful as you say on the tin, and good job so far.
Thanks. It's been fun. It's oddly enough, like, you know how, like, how painful it is just to configure stuff. And like, that's my job now. But it's not as bad because I know that I'm like doing it once and for all, or, you know, like I'm doing it so I don't have to do it again. And so everybody else doesn't have to do it.
Actually, where did the name Blitz.js come from? What just helped you decide on that?
I don't know. It just came from thin air, I guess. I'm not sure like quite how, where the idea came from. Other than like it kind of resonated with me because it tied in with, which it was Zeit then, which was, is German for time, and Blitz is German for lightning. And so it's kind of like, kind of an ode to them. And Prisma's German also. So, you know, so, and I have German background, but then also Blitz being lightning fast. And I don't know, it's just a cool name. So
cool. Well, I know you wanted to show off some of this. So maybe if we could, if you're cool, we could just bring in your screen and you could show some of this off and we could use that to take the conversation from there, if that sounds good.
Sure thing.
All right, so bring it up. And I'll also encourage, while Brandon's going through this, if you do have any questions, to drop them in chat. So I'll be monitoring that as well.
So what I'm showing you here is how you create a new app. So you can install the Blitz CLI globally or run npx blitz new and then give it a name of an app. And it will prompt you for a form library. And then you can see it'll generate a bunch of files. And so this can be a little bit intimidating for folks because there's a bunch of files here, but what we're optimizing for is productivity for building like a real app, not just for impressive, like that's extremely simple getting started and then you have to do all the work yourself.
Yeah. And so I guess one question would be, it like, where is Blitz.js a good fit? And it sounds like probably for things that are more involved, right? Like you're not building, probably maybe a little bit overkill for like a basic to-do app.
Well, if you need a database, then like Blitz is your jam, you know? If you need to save data in a database and you want to do that yourself, then Blitz is great because like it's simple. Like what you get out of the box is simple, but it's just like kind of everything you need. So it has user sign up, login, authentication, logout, forgot password flows already set up. So it's like, as soon as you run Blitz dev here, then like all that is ready to go. And so you can just focus on building your to-do app or whatever. So it really is a good fit for everything from just very simple side projects that, especially like if you need a database, and then all the way up to like building your next startup.
Yeah, I kind of remember the process here. When I got this part going and I looked at it, it said, log in or sign in or register. And I'm like, I was trying to go to the database so I could like manually insert a record thinking I had to do that. But now all the screens are there and they all work. And that was my first joyful moment with Blitz. That and your tutorial was like perfectly done.
Awesome. Good to hear. So I'm just starting it up here and we can see what it looks like.
Yeah, I was going to say, it almost feels like you're doing two projects every time you set something up, especially when you're setting up the object relations and doing database stuff, you know, once for auth and then for the actual fun stuff or your content. And it seems to abstract that in a really nice way.
So we're making monoliths cool again.
It's all a circle, Brandon. It's all a circle.
We had the Utah ones only a few months ago. It's nice that they're staying relevant.
What was that?
The Utah monoliths.
Oh, yeah.
True. That's true.
Yeah. So you can see this is what you get just out of the box. So we can click sign up and we can just sign up. And then you can see that we already have a user ID, a role, and then we can log out and do everything.
So where do you store these? Like, what is the database by default and is it configurable?
Yeah, so by default, out of the box, you have SQLite set up. Just a second. Okay. So in your DB folder, you have a db.sqlite file by default. And that is configurable in the Prisma schema. So right now, Prisma works with Postgres, MySQL, and SQLite. They're working on Mongo support. But you don't have to use Prisma for Blitz. You can use anything like TypeORM or Fauna or anything else, but Blitz provides the best developer experience. So you can see here in your Prisma schema, you can define your, right now it's SQLite, but you can change that to Postgres, which I recommend for production.
And I don't think I know what Prisma is, actually. Maybe I should, but could you give like a 1 minute introduction to what that actually is?
Prisma is the MVP of the next decade. So Prisma is the, it's an ORM, a next generation ORM is what they call it. And so it allows you to define your database schema in a GraphQL like syntax, as you can see here, for your model, your fields, your types. And then you run Prisma Migrate and it'll update your database. So it'll generate SQL migration files, which you can customize or whatever you need to do. So it does that, handles that part. And then also it provides a database client that's fully typed. So we can go into like this query here, get current user, and you can see right here, we import the database object, which is Prisma, and you call db.user.findFirst. You can pass in a query thing like where, you can select certain things, you can sort, filter, include relations, and then it's fully typed with TypeScript. And so the return type is like exactly, comes all the way from the database. And then in Blitz, this flows all the way to the front end. And so if we go to the index page, and you can see we're have this use current user hook, and you can see the type is exactly the same. And that's without, like with GraphQL, you have to have this like GraphQL code generator that's sitting there running, generating your types for you. With Prisma, it's just in Blitz, you don't have to do that. It's just always there.
Interesting. It looks like Blitz also uses TypeScript by default, I'm guessing.
Yes. Yep.
Cool.
So we're working on you can still, I think we have JS support, plain JS support. It's kind of iffy right now. There may be some bugs, but we're going to be making that like first class, but still recommend TypeScript. And a bunch of people have been learning TypeScript with Blitz to great success. So
cool.
Yeah. It seems like a lot of the time on the back end for full stack stuff like this, or with just different AWS services, you're going to be using sort of older versions of JS. And it's nice to see TypeScript kind of as a first class citizen with this whole environment.
So everything we do is like designed with TypeScript in mind.
Yeah, one of the things I noted in the tutorial, this is the question and answer one I'm talking about specifically, is you go right into things with relationships. And that's sometimes an area that full stack framework people avoid because it's actually drifting into the harder problems to solve. So maybe you could like talk a little bit about how that works.
Sure. So what we'll do here is, we have these, we're heavily inspired by Ruby on Rails. So like there's a Rails console, which is a REPL. You also have Blitz console, which works the same way. You can just like play with your database really easy. So that's sweet. We also have Blitz generate. So we can do Blitz generate all project and just say it has a name of string. And right now this generation is like, code generation is still kind of basic. Like if you update you can't add fields after the fact, but we're going to be adding that. So we'll just say, yeah, migrate the database. And so now that you can see it generates like all the CRUD files for a project. So in this case, it has the pages for viewing a list of projects, viewing a single project, editing a project, and then creating a new one. And then it has a form for that, and then queries and mutations for all those CRUD operations too. So then we can, I'll just go ahead and generate a task. So, and we're gonna say generate all task. In this case, we're gonna say it has a name of string and it belongs to a project. And then we also have to pass parent project right now, which should be optimized. And so what this is going to do is generate another task model so it belongs to a project. So each project will have its own task.
What is the all in that command doing there?
It's generating all the files that we can generate. So you can do just blitz generate pages, blitz generate queries, blitz generate query, blitz generate mutation, but all will generate all the possible files that we can for a given model.
I see. So you're saying generate, we're basically creating a new thing called task, generate everything for it. And this is going to be like within a project, which is something you previously generated.
Correct.
Okay.
So yeah.
I like the fact that you limit what can be generated or allow all, because I've bumped into trouble in projects with lots of code gen where someone would just generate everything and then it would get out of sync and they really only needed one piece. And so it's thoughtful to be able just to pick and choose.
Yep. And then right, we're going to be adding ability to define your own templates too. So that like with Rails, like most people don't end up not using most of the code generation because like once you get a project up and running, you want to generate like the template comes out of the box isn't what you want, right? And so we're going to give you ability to override, like add your own templates. And hopefully even like your own custom things like Blitz generate, I don't know, whatever, like some other custom thing that you define.
Yeah, I'm thinking like so, Angular has things for like components, all sorts of different things that it's built in. So I could see there's definitely some potential.
Yeah. So this the dash dash parent flag nested the pages under the project's pages. So it's project/project ID/task, and then all of those CRUD things are there. So everything's nested under a project. And then the code that's generated in the queries and mutations also reflect that it's under a specific project.
And it should be obvious, but in this case, project is actually a base entity type that has tasks, right?
Yes. So here in the the generated code, you can see that project ID name created that, and then we're going to also add a task, and this is going to be task and array, and then a task has all of that stuff, and then it has a field, a project ID field, which relates back up to the parent project.
And I guess I'm curious what got generated for like the actual like UI or pages when you did all of this as well.
Sure. So let me just run that final migration and start the server again.
And while that's happening, I did notice you could name your migrations in the database, but I wasn't sure what that did. So I kept just skipping it. Did I blow it? Did I make a mistake?
No. So it is, you're naming the migration files on your computer. So you can see right here, db/migrations. So it's prefixed with a timestamp. And then if you provide it a name, it'll add a plain text to that. So it's easy to reference when
gotcha.
You're looking at that. Because see, you can open up that migration and modify that the raw SQL if you need. Okay, so what's generated? So this is /projects. So it's a project list, currently nothing here. So we can create a new one. And stream on Twitch, create that. And so now it takes us to /projects/1, the ID. To view that, you can edit it, delete. And currently it only adds a name field. It doesn't respect any of the other fields that you create, but that's something we'll add. Okay, so then also task. So we can do just add task on the end of this. And now we're viewing the list of tasks for that specific project. And so we can do the same thing, create a task. And then it shows that, okay? So now, yeah. And so then you could go back and you could modify your project's queries or whatever, but that's the basics.
And at this point, are the pages, so, are they fully editable at this point? Basically, is Blitz just generating like the starting point for you for these? And then from there, it's like up to you to do whatever you need to do.
Yes. So the project's index page is what we're showing you right now. And so it has kind of like all the basics that you would want, like setting the title, you know, a couple links, adding authentication. layout component. And this is stuff that, especially the authentication that Blitz adds on top of Next, like you can't do this thing right here in Next, but that's a Blitz thing, so that if you're not logged in, it'll automatically show a login form. And so you have the list of projects here, has pagination set up by default, and use paginated query. Now, so this gets into that zero API data layer thing. So this get projects, we import a function and we pass it to use paginated query, which is built on top of a React query. So it does all the awesome cache invalidation ability, features for like polling, et cetera. It's super cool. So if we just go look at that get projects thing, you can see, so we export a default function, and this can be any asynchronous function, but we have some utilities called, we have a resolver utilities, specifically a functional pipe that allows you to pipe multiple things. And in this case, we are calling resolver to authorize, which ensures that you're logged in. And you could also add a role. So you could say authorize admin, and then only admins could access this. Okay. And then we have the function here where we're going to call a paginate. It's another utility we have. And then inside that, we're calling database.project.findMini. And then we just return that. So between these two files, like that's all it is for your full stack operation. There's no REST, no GraphQL. You just write this function that runs on the server, import it into your component, pass it to a use query hook, and then it works straight away. And then we also have a invoke function. So you could just do like invoke get projects and then pass your arg. So like where, whatever. And then you could do this outside of React. So it's just like calling a function. And then compile time, we swap that out with a API call.
We did have a few questions come in through the chat that I wanted to bring up here real quick. Christian is curious, any out of the box or preferred conventions for integration with third-party APIs?
No, not really, other than we have a integrations folder in the root of your repository that we is set up for integration. So you could put like integration/Stripe, integration/Century, all those sort third-party things. But beyond that, we don't have any current specific conventions.
And like, how would that, do you offer like pre-built integrations, or do you like, could you see you adding that in the future? Like I need Stripe and like, there's some easy way for me to add it sort of thing.
Yeah, good question. So we have a thing called recipes that allows you to install anything there's a recipe for in one command. So for example, Tailwind install or Blitz install Tailwind will automatically install all the dependencies that this thing needs and configuration, like if it has any config files, if it has any React context providers that you need to add, it'll add that for you. And so we don't have a lot of these right now, and it's kind of difficult to write them, but we're going to be making it much easier to write them. And anybody can write them. We have some that are official in the Blitz repo, but then you can also pull it from like any GitHub repo, Blitz install like the GitHub username / the repo name.
Yeah, this is powerful. I know Dan and I have some experience in the past of working on like a extension thing, and it's like the greatest and worst thing ever for a project, right? Like, because it's amazing what you can do, but then like it also gets hard in terms of just maintaining quality, and you know, if something gets popular that people use, and making sure that it works with later versions. Have you thought through like any plans around doing that, or is it a little bit early for that?
A lot of the setup stuff is pretty basic and like doesn't really change between like where you provide your providers is always in like the root, you know, but like it's just JS code shift really under the hood is like code mods. So you could, I mean, you, yeah, it's right now there's no, like upgrade features or anything. It's just like a one-time thing, but yeah. It would be cool to make them more like a sort of more like a plugin where, you could have like, depending on what your Blitz version was, it would kind of change the code. potentially.
Do you see those recipes being more like a community-driven effort?
Yeah, well, Blitz itself is community-driven. So it's, so yeah, everything is community-driven.
Definitely. Yeah, I just see the idea of getting, you know, even a specific version of something working within Blitz, you know, being easy to set up a recipe and share that with someone.
Yeah, that's the idea. That is,
yeah, one of the happy and sad truths of open source is like what the community will actually do. And many open source people think they can build a little bit and the community will build all the rest. And I'm sure you figured out that isn't the case. You almost have to own the hard bits and then leave the kind of less dependency or more straightforward things for the community, because that's something they're able to grok and be productive with, but they're not really going to come rewrite your compiler for you unless you find like that one crazy person who has time on their hands.
Yeah, that's a good
point. How are you feeling with the response from the community? Are they able to help out how you want?
Yeah, so back when I first launched Blitz and announced it and the tweet kind of went viral, you can read about it on the Blitz.js history page in our docs. I didn't even have a GitHub repo. I only had a couple hundred lines of prototype code on my computer. But in that announcement, I was like I was just kind of casting the vision, right? And everybody was like excited about it. And so I said, hey, I need help to build this. And so about 45 people responded that they wanted to help in some way. And probably maybe 15 of those actually helped in a meaningful way. And then a number of those are still around today. But one of those was our designer, Christina, that designed the logo for free, designed the new website that we just launched the other week. So that was awesome. We had somebody come in and built, actually a lot of the infrastructure code I didn't build. Like somebody built the CLI, somebody built the compiler that we have. And so now contributions have died off quite a bit from what it was earlier on, probably like because it's, you know, it's just kind of more complex. So it'd be great to have more people thing, but it, you know, it kind of revolves. Like some people are come in for a while, then they leave, and then someone else comes in. And so it just is what it is.
Yeah, there was an old children's story called Stone Soup. I don't know if you ever read that or not. You ever read that? So this guy goes into a village and he's starving and he has nothing. So he gets a pot and puts some stones in it. And the people come by and go, what are you doing? He's like, oh, I'm cooking stone soup. It's amazing. And they're like, well, can I have something? He's like, yeah, be better if you brought a little something with it. It's like, well, I got some carrots. So they throw the carrots in there and someone else comes and brings the cabbage. And the next thing you got meat and they're all enjoying the stone soup. And it's phenomenal. Sometimes I think open source a bit like that.
Yeah.
Then you need to get into the children's book business. You write the stone soup version for open source developers.
Totally. You wouldn't believe the like children stories that run through my head on a daily basis. Like when I drive in traffic and I get cut off, I'm thinking of children's stories, you know, Old Mother Goose or something like that.
We've got actually quite a few really good questions that came in. So a question about integration outside of Prisma Fauna, which I do not recognize, but any plan to support other databases in this fashion?
Sure. Fauna is a serverless database. So you have to either use GraphQL or FQL, which are the new syntax. And we currently have a Fauna example in the Blitz monorepo. So you can check that out to show how to integrate Fauna.
And then there's same person also asked Prisma Studio, any plans to support a more robust admin scaffolding such as React Admin?
I've not really looked at React Admin or used that much. But yeah, the admin stuff is definitely important, and I would love if you have ideas on how to, you know, integrate stuff like that with Blitz.
You know, CodeTech is someone I know in real life, and they're the ones that showed me Blitz in the first place. He sent me a YouTube video you did, Brandon, and said, you got to watch this. It's a game changer. And I went, oh God, what is it going to be? And it turned out it was everything I ever wanted it to be. Like all the stuff I don't want to build right out of the box.
Awesome.
And then one other question from Jalen, is the developer limited to how Blitz decides to set things up, or is there an opportunity to customize this based on the requirements that might be outside how Blitz works by default?
Well, this is a good one.
I think the answer is no. So one of our foundational principles is loose opinions, which means that we have opinions about how we recommend you should do things, but there's very little that we enforce. And so for the most part, you can totally blaze your own trail and organize your code how you want. You know, do whatever you want. Like anything you can do in Next.js, you can do in Blitz. In fact, Blitz has less restrictions than Next.js. So you even have a bit more freedom.
Yeah, I think that's the sort of trade-off challenge there is, how do you build a productive zero API framework and yet let other people bring their own opinions? Like, that's super hard.
I think if you have the right abstraction, that, you know, it makes it easier. So our zero API thing is really sweet because, like, we're just providing the pipe, but whatever you pass through there is up to you. And so one thing we do with that pipe between the front end and the back end is advanced serialization using Super JSON, which is a library we wrote just for this. And it automatically serializes dates, maps, sets, regex, big ints, like most of the things that JSON.stringify doesn't support. We support those. And so if you return a date on the server, it comes out as a date on the client without you doing anything, which is, I personally just love so much.
How does hosting work? Do you work with, will this work with anything, any hosting provider that supports Next, or is there anything else that you need to know? How does all that work?
Yeah. So supports anywhere you can run a node server. You can run Blitz as just a regular Blitz server. And then, yeah, you can deploy, which is the same for Next. You can deploy anywhere a regular node server. If you want to deploy serverless, then yes, you can deploy anywhere that Next.js serverless works. So Vercel, you can deploy Blitz to AWS. You can use the serverless Next.js framework plugin to deploy Blitz, because Blitz outputs the same .next file that Next.js does.
Very cool. I guess you covered a little bit of this earlier, but I'm curious, like, maybe you could give us a quick rundown of the things that Blitz does on top of Next.js. Like, what are some, you've covered some of these features already, but I'd be curious if you just give us like a list of just cool things that Blitz does.
Okay. So let's just show you a couple. So there's some advanced features that you can do when you're dealing with authentication that we provide by default. So one thing you'll notice in this index page, we have this feature that you can on the page, you can say suppress first render flicker equals true. And if we just take that out and open up this page, the home page, with the nature of how Next.js works, that a server renders a static, actually this might be a, okay. So the loading screen is rendered on the server. And so when it loads on the client, it has to be that the loading screen, and before it switches to something else, even if that other thing is ready on that first render. So that's the case with authentication. So we use cookies. So on the first render, we know whether you're logged in or not, but we have to render once with the logged out version to match for the React hydration to match the server. And so that's what this thing does here. So you can set suppress first render flicker true, and it will hide that first render so that it immediately shows logout. And here we're using we're actually doing a database query here, and so it doesn't show that. But if we were just using the use session hook, it would. And then it also works for. So if we log out, and go to any of the other pages. So let's go to the pages index, and this is where we have the projects index. Page.authenticate equals true. So this does the same thing, the same technique for minimizing that flash. And it loads a login form in this case. So then same thing for like projects, and then projects new. And then we also have a thing for logged in users. So like the sign up page, we have a redirect authenticated to. And so if you're logged in, it'll redirect you to somewhere else so you aren't on the sign up page or login page.
The choice to include SQL Lite, I think, is really brilliant because right out of the box, you can kind of get going and do stuff. But let's imagine for a minute, kind of like the position I'm in now, is I've been hacking away at this for a while. And I'm like, okay, it's time to use a grown-up database. What's my migration path look like?
We have a doc page on that, switching to Postgres. And essentially, you change the provider name in the Prisma schema file, and then change your ENV variable database URL to point to your Postgres database, which we kind of set it up for you so you can just uncomment it. And then you need to delete all your existing migration files in the DB folder, and then just run Prisma migrate, and it'll generate a new migration for Postgres.
I like your phrasing, Dan. The doc article should show, but totally be named. So I'm ready to use a grown-up database. What do I do?
Well, if I'm not mistaken, like SQLite has problems with concurrency, but maybe I'm thinking of an older issue. So you'd want to, at some point, if you get more than a few users, get something that's kind of meant for something for more than a few users. But for getting something up and going, like I say, I did the tutorial works exactly like it says it does. There was no dark alleys. I kept typing things started to happen. The CLI would hint to me what I needed to do and like offer to fill out the commands intelligently. And I'm like, I don't know if I'm really needed here. Like I just need to sit back and let Blitz build the application.
Oh, funny. So I like
that
something
that loose opinions comes into that as well. Like in the same way, it's abstracted nicely for you to not have to worry about all these things, but at the same time, it provides you everything that you're working with, and you know you can extend them out from there.
Now, something else Blitz adds on top of Next is ability to have multiple pages folders, which allows you to organize them. So you can see here we have app. Under the top level app folders, like where you put all your main code, and under we have a top app auth, and then everything related to auth is in there: components, mutations, pages. So like with Next.js, you can only have a single pages, but here we have pages here, and then we also have pages down here. And so we merge those together at build time for you. And so that allows you to like isolate by team. Or in this case, if you don't want auth for some reason, you can just delete the auth folder and it goes away.
And you have some consideration for internationalization baked in. Is that part of what you're showing now, or could you walk through that? I know that's important for some folks in our audience.
We currently don't have, we don't add anything on top of Next for internationalization. So Next has built-in support for it, at least to some extent. And that is something I haven't thought about much, but there have been folks that have said that they want Blitz to do like build more internationalization stuff on top of what Next provides. And so that's something we'll be looking into, but nothing that I can comment on right now, or nothing that I don't even have anything to comment.
So your website has a want free stickers link. So I'm curious what the story is behind there.
Refrigerator behind him that may or may not have stickers on it.
Yeah, you might notice that I have a thing for stickers. I've got a collection back there. So I'm curious, like what the story was behind that, and like what the sort of demand is, like because it to me, like I'm thinking for me, I'd be hesitant to just put a form that just ships out random stickers because I would think that like bots or whatever would come to take it over. So I'm curious how that works.
They're coming for my stickers.
So I'm just using an Airtable form right now. And I'm refreshing right now to see what it was. So I just put that up on the beta launch, which was like 2 weeks ago, I think.
Okay.
And we currently have 220 people signed up to get stickers. So go to blitzjs.com/stickers and you can put in your details there. And we have a awesome lady in the Blitz community who's going to be mailing those out.
That is awesome. You're about to have 221 here as I'm filling out the form right now.
Yeah, swag is like it's a key part of developer marketing. Stickers. Nope.
Stickers you can also go to store.blitzjs.com. And then you can buy t-shirts, all kinds of stuff, and that's not free, but it is there.
Do you have blankets? I could use a good blanket.
No, but I could. Teespring probably has blankets.
Oh, well, I've used Teespring before. They're actually pretty great if you need custom stuff and don't want to go through all the rigmarole of printing it yourself and putting it somewhere. In fact, I still have swag in my closet from products I no longer work with, so I'll never be cool
the logistics,
again, I guess.
The logistics is something nobody wants to deal with.
Yeah.
So Brandon, I have a question really quick actually about nested routing. Is that something that's just handled by Next.js, or is there any opinionation that comes from Blitz regarding that?
So it's just, we don't do anything with routing. So it's exactly what Next.js provides.
Cool. Was just wondering that in kind of the lens of if you have, you know, a specific route that's protected by auth or anything like that, but Next does make that very easy.
So would you say the right workflow would be to generate all the stubs that you need and then begin kind of hand editing them to fill them out? Is that the way you see someone using Blitz the best, or is there another workflow you like?
Yeah, especially for the queries and mutations. So if you run, so there's Blitz generate model, which is just an easy way to set up the Prisma models. So that's pretty useful. Regardless of what your UI code looks like. Blitz generate queries and mutations. If you do CRUD, it generates queries and mutations. And if you generate resource, it does model queries and mutations. And so those like server side things are the ones that are really helpful because it generates. We looked at one of those. So let's say create project mutation. Like there's this basic stuff that you always want in your mutations. You always want a Zod schema, which it's a validation tool like Yup, but it works better with TypeScript. And so in this case, we define our input to be an object and to take a name of string. And then the return type of that is via TypeScript. TypeScript is typed. And so we pass in resolver.pipe. So I'm just kind of reformatting this a little bit. Okay, so resolver.zod takes in that Zod schema. And so it'll automatically validate your input at runtime. And then also provides the TypeScript definition for your input. So you can see here that name is string. And so that's like really seamless. And then inside this, you know, you do your normal stuff. And so this basic setup is you're always going to want this. And so this is really helpful to come in and then you can customize it if you need. The UI is going to be more bespoke. But if you're still just starting out, then yeah, I definitely recommend just generating the pages that we have to give you a starting point.
What would you say has been your like happiest moment with Blitz?
The whole thing.
When you hatched this idea, did you know what you were getting yourself into?
Yeah. So I had a phone call with a Ruby on Rails developer, a friend of mine, and we were like going back and forth about Rails versus React and like the trade-offs and things. And like I was kind of frustrated because I couldn't like really win because I couldn't argue that like this whole React stack with the API and stuff was like more productive or simple than Rails. And so anyways, that sparked an idea. I was like, you know what? I think now we can build on top of Next.js and Prisma. And so 1 week after that is when I announced it with like, you know, just a very simple prototype. But I knew, like, okay, I didn't want to spend a bunch of time building this thing and nobody wanted it. I was pretty sure people would wanted this, but I wanted to make sure. And so that's why I did the announcement. And then I saw like, okay, yeah, tons of people want this. And so like, all right, here we go. I was working on another startup, like a bookmark manager. So I just like threw that away and just went whole hog on Blitz.
Yeah, I think I've done much worse things for dumber reasons. So I applaud you for sticking it through.
No, I think like, and you could tell me if you agree with this, but I think there's been a broader trend in the React world of people looking for more, I'd say like opinionated, guided resources, because I feel like for a while, the cool thing in React was like, oh, it's like almost like low level, right? Like it's, you can pick whatever CSS thing you want to do. You can pick whatever state management thing you want to do. But the thing is, like for some people, that's great, but a lot of people just want to work on whatever app they need to get done, right? So you get overwhelmed with choices. So I think there's something really appealing about like React queries, just how this is baked in, and that's just how you do queries. And the SQL approach is just baked in, and your auth is done for you, because at the end of the day, we're here to build apps. And for the most part, you don't need to worry, at least most developers don't need to worry about all these little decisions. Like you can lots of times be a lot more productive with something that just comes out of the box with a lot of these things done for you.
Yeah, and add to that, our last couple episodes have dealt with what happens in complex environments when there's too many choices, or maybe the right ones aren't made or followed. And like you're saying, TJ, offloading a lot of that choice architecture to Blitz, where it's sort of this thing that you don't have to mess with and it does its own thing without you having to mess with it too much. It seems like an easy decision to make to just put that to one side, and then you can make all the decisions with your custom code. And maybe that's a better use of time than arguing which router or which query or which API to use.
Yeah. And in fact, I've been a bit surprised that like people want Blitz to be even more opinionated than it is.
I'm not surprised.
Yeah. And so yeah, it'll be interesting to, you know, see where we are a year from now.
Let's stick with that. Are you going to ask the follow up on that one, TJ?
Yeah. What is next for Blitz? Like, what sort of things are you planning on adding? What sort of things would you like to see? All those sorts of things.
So our current focus is on getting to 1.0, hopefully around April-ish timeframe, and so mainly I'm just like fixing bugs, like edge cases and things. And I think we're actually going to be forking Next.js and maintaining a fork, keeping up to date with Next, but maintaining a fork.
So Ruh-roh. There be dragons.
Yeah, I know. But we have some fundamental issues right now with how we're doing it. It's bad. Like honestly, it's kind of a hacky, because we're compiling we're taking your Blitz code, compiling it to the .blitz folder, and then running Next.js from there. And so it kind of sets up this like double file watcher process where you change a file, it's copied to Blitz, then that changes, and the Next.js detects that and then recompiles. And so that's working 1.0. I'm also going to be working on like some type of a starter kit that for SaaS products that builds out like team functionality, billing, that sort of stuff. And I'm still not sure yet whether it's going to be paid or free, or, you know, something. So that's going to be coming. And then after 1.0, later this year, I'm going to be working on first class React Native support, so that it brings the zero API data layer to React Native apps. So you can have a monorepo with your Blitz app, your React Native app, import your Blitz queries and mutations directly into your React Native code, and then we would compile that into automatically into the RPC API too.
Very cool. But is there anything about Blitz that we haven't discussed? Anything you think people really need to know that we haven't gotten into?
I think we've covered most of it.
Any final questions from chat? People are dying to know. We'll do one last call on questions. If anybody has anything, Mickey, do you have any other things that we haven't gotten to?
I guess the only other thing that I had in the docket was talking about sort of importing database relations. Like if you have an existing database, or sometimes what I do for like a single page app is just set up like a JSON that I'm going to be using. And then, you know, that's sort of the source of truth until I get a front end built out and then actually go to a more sophisticated database. Is that something that is supported with maybe with the CLI and the generate command and stuff like that?
Sorry, I was slightly distracted and I missed. Can you just rephrase that?
Oh yeah, you're all good. Basically just wondering about whether it's via the generate CLI or just importing another database to work with a Blitz application.
So converting an existing app to Blitz?
Yeah, exactly.
If it's using Next.js, then it's pretty simple to convert to Blitz, yeah. And you can take any existing database, and if you want to use Prisma, Prisma has a introspect command, or they're actually, I think what they released yesterday is called DB pool. And it'll just take any database and it'll generate the Prisma schema from your whatever database you already have. Awesome. As long as that's supported by Prisma. But.
Mm-hmm.
And so we had one last question come in from chat. Kotech wants to know, BlitzGuard seems to be the de facto attributes-based access control method. And if so, are there any plans to integrate that into Blitz, or will it remain external?
Yeah, so BlitzGuard is a really cool library by the community. It's like a centralized permission-based authorization library. So you can do it's centralized where you can define like certain users with certain roles can update or manage or delete, or they can't do certain operations on certain models. Currently, there's no plans to integrate it into Blitz. It's really good. I think there's maybe opportunity to do even better. We'll see. But BlitzGuard is, for those who know Rails, it's like can. It's very similar.
My experience with Rails doesn't go much past the fact it uses active record pattern and you can build a blog in 10 minutes.
Yep, 15, I think.
Although when that video came out, I was like, wow, that's way better than what I'm doing now.
Yeah.
Which is not building a blog in 15 minutes.
Yeah. So we've had a ton of people that are already using Blitz in production. We have, so there was one, a fellow early Blitz user, and he said that he worked professionally with Rails for 10 years. And after just a few months with working with Blitz, he's already 10 times more productive than he ever was with Rails, which is just.
And I read a blog in 1.5 minutes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I think there was a question from Mickey that I don't know if we got to, and I am curious myself. So let's imagine that I start this application project on my own and I have like a flat JSON file that has all my relationships in it. How would I get to like Blitz status with that file? Is it all like bring it over by hand? Do you have some magic thingerator that takes JSON and makes entities out of it? Or what's your ideas there?
No, but happy to take PRs.
Right.
Or libraries.
Best answer you could give.
Actually, that might be a good point. Like a last question here to cover is if people either want to get started with a framework, where's the best place for them to do so? And if they even wanted to get involved, like on like GitHub contributing and such, what would you recommend for that as well?
So go to blitzjs.com is our documentation. That's the best place to get started. We also have a page there on how to contribute. We would love you to contribute. We have a really awesome Blitz community that's working together on Blitz, helping each other out in chat. And you can like get involved with Blitz as much as you want. We have a level one maintainer that you could be that helps kind of like do issue triage, help people. We have a level two maintainer for people who are more involved and have more ownership over code and reviewing PRs. And then So yeah, I would love to have your help in any way you can, even if it's just, you know, some here, some there. It all helps. We label our issues very clearly about what's ready to work on, and then good first issue, good second issue, and so forth. And you can also be a sponsor, either as an individual for as low as $5 a month, and then also companies can sponsor and get their logos, you know, on up for higher tiers. So if you work at a company that does sponsorships, then you can talk to them about sponsoring Blitz. That would be awesome.
You know, as I mentioned at the beginning, it seems like since we booked you, the popularity has gone through the roof for Blitz. Like, it feels like there's this groundswell that's starting to take off, and like Twitter mentions and articles and stuff. Like, what is that like for you? Is it distracting? Is it validation? Is it both? Like, how do you see it?
It's basically been that way ever since day one. So it's just surfing the wave.
Just what it is. Yeah. Cause everything seems so well done. Like, your website looks amazing. The docs are great. The tutorial actually works. And believe me, I've tried some products lately that it may or may not work. So it all seems quite put together. You know, I applaud you and wish you great success.
Yeah, I appreciate it. It is challenging. Like, you have to be very intentional about, you know, juggling all these different things. And then, you know, but there's been people, you know, like somebody, the designer did the website for free. There's been people who helped build the website. And so I've definitely had a lot of help, and Blitz is like way, 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 way better than if it was just me slaving away by myself for a year. So
it's exciting.
Yeah. And I'll say too, that what you were mentioning around the issue tracker, and I'll just drop this link in the chat too. This is really nice because I've been involved with a lot of open source projects, and it's usually when you go to the issue list, it's just a hot mess, both for just a person that's casually looking at this, but especially for like someone that wants to get involved, because it's just like, well, this is just a complete bucket of who knows what. So this is actually extremely approachable. Like, the labels tell me the sort of things that I can contribute with, because I mean, I got started in open source just basically triaging for a project, right? And like, I think people undervalue how important that actually is, just like being the person that deals on the front lines of issues that comes in and helps research some of these things is incredibly, incredibly valuable, but people don't seem to realize that. And it can be a path to getting more involved. So it is really cool. Absolutely. To see these labels like consistently used, because I think it's pretty, pretty sweet.
You really said something great there, TJ, and that's that people who want to get involved think they have to do something elaborate to be useful, but often it's really just putting a little bit of ideas and effort in can make a big difference.
Yep. Even if you only like triage one issue per week or something, you know, like, that's still helpful.
And also the act of doing the triage will help you learn more about whatever it is you're interested in doing, so that you can become even more involved in whatever it is.
Right.
Well, cool. This has been a lot of fun. One thing we'd like to end with is just sort of like plugs. Is there anything else other than Blitz, Brandon, that you want to plug or you want to spread the word on?
I've been enjoying Clubhouse and Twitter Spaces recently.
I'm not hipster enough to be in there yet. Do you have a preference for which?
I think for like web dev, tech community is probably going to be the place to be is a Twitter Spaces. But I think Clubhouse is also going to thrive for other communities. Like I've been listening into some rooms from like quantum physics people, and it's just like way over my head, but it's still like so interesting. And there's all these people from around the world just chatting about these things, you know, so.
I need to check that out. Maybe we have to get React Wednesdays on Clubhouse. Give it the trends, give it the times.
Yeah, maybe I'll have to get an iPhone because they're pretty anti-Android for some reason.
Twitter Spaces are working on Android right now. They have a meeting, actually it might be going on right now, Twitter Space, talking about Android. I think people with Android on Twitter can be in Spaces now, but they can't host them quite yet. So they're moving pretty rapid on this. Yeah.
Yeah, it's 2021. Like, we gotta end the device specific stuff.
Mickey, do you have anything you want to plug?
Nothing other than that. I'm excited about the future of Blitz and following where you guys are going with it and see how the community puts this app together.
Cool. Dan, how about you? You got any plugs?
Yeah, I'll plug up the newsletter and just say that developers like Mickey submit all the articles, so they're way better than if I came up with them. So you should totally subscribe.
Awesome. And I'll one more time. So I've been dropping all these links in the chat. I'll drop the React Wednesdays one more time. Just remind you, you can subscribe to the calendar. We do this every week. We bring in awesome people like Brandon. So we're going to be talking about Microsoft Teams apps next week, which should be interesting. Remotion videos with React, Recoil. So some really good stuff coming up. So subscribe if you want to get notifications about that. But for this week, thanks one more time, Brandon. This has been a lot of fun. I definitely learned a lot about Blitz. So really appreciate you taking the time.
Awesome. Thank you.
Thanks, Tom.
Sweet. Y'all have a good one.
All right. Yep. Until next week, everybody. See you.